your hearts and help you to draw closer to Him than you've ever been before. Amen. We're in a time, folks, that we have to seek the face of God. And we need to do it while it's day. Because when night comes, thank you. Rose of Sharon showed me how to grow in beauty in God's sight. Jesus. And fairies of 10,000 make me a reflection of your light. Day stars shine down on me, and let your love shine through me in the night. to you tonight. We've been talking about, started on last Tuesday night, we started talking about prayer. Prayer is the doorway into the presence of Almighty God. Amen. Prayer is the doorway into the presence of Almighty God. And so we're going to continue along that line today, and we pray that God will begin to minister to your heart, because you see, prayer is the avenue that God will use to bring healing to our land. Prayer is the avenue that God will use to bring healing into our land, that will bring the peace of God into our land, that will bring the power of God into our land. Prayer is the doorway that God will use, amen, to minister to your loved ones. You may have a loved one that is sick right now, and you said, well, it was meant for him to be sick or her to be sick. No, it's the thief that comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. Jesus said, I come that you may have life, not that you may have sickness and disease. He said, I come that you may have life, and that more abundantly. Amen. He said in 3 John 2, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. So we know that according to the word of God, that God is not looking at our sicknesses and thinking that it's a good thing. It is not something that God has brought upon us. It is an attack of the enemy trying to take us out of this place. Amen. And so as we pray, God said in the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 12, he said, and the Lord appeared unto Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer. Notice what he said, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. See, a lot of times when we're praying, it is actually a sacrifice. Amen. It's a sacrifice because, see, we can think of a whole lot of other things that we'd rather be doing than to be somewhere praying. Amen. Because, you know, the devil, he want to make sure that you have all these ideas coming up in your head, something that will keep you from praying. Amen. He wants you to know that he's already working on your behalf to stop you or to interfere with your prayer. How does he do that? He do that by bringing up different thoughts into your mind, and all of a sudden you say, well, I need to be over here doing this to my car, or I need to be doing this in my kitchen, or I need to be zapping the floor. What is he doing? He's bringing all these thoughts, see, into your head right now at the time that you need to be spending time with God in prayer. This enemy, which is Satan, he's bringing all these thoughts to you that you be sidetracked or not even able to pray or to seek the face of God. Amen. Because he's interfering, and he's bringing a spirit of deception upon you, and you're not able to discern it because you're not praying. Amen. You're not praying. So God wants us to pray. God wants us to pray. Notice what he said, verse number 12 again, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse number 12. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. For a house of sacrifice. In verse number 13 said, If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, then he said in verse number 14, If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, notice what he said, then will I hear from heaven. He said, then will I hear from heaven. Amen. Then will I hear from heaven. Now notice what else he said, and will forgive their sin. Amen. So God wants to hear from heaven, but the only way that's going to happen, folks, if we as God people begin to pray. Because he said, if my people would pray. Amen. So that means that there's a blessing if you would pray, but if you don't pray, there's a consequence. Amen. There's a consequence if you don't pray. Amen. But if you pray, there is a blessing that God will bring about in your life. Amen. There's a blessing that God will bring about in your life. Glory to God. What kind of blessing will bring? He said, if my people pray, amen. He said, if my people pray, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked way, he said, then I will, glory to God. Oh, glory to God. And turn from their wicked way, then I will hear from heaven. See, that's a blessing that we will hear from heaven. That, amen. He said, then I will hear from heaven. Then he said, and I will forgive their sins. Isn't that a blessing that God wants to forgive your sin? No matter where you are in life, no matter what you've been doing, no matter what lifestyle you've lived, God, he's not going to look at your lifestyle. He's not going to look at your past. He's going to look at your present so he can push you on into your future. Amen. How's that going to happen? It's going to happen when you acknowledge your need for God. Amen. Your need for God. How do you know that we need God today in our life? We need God today in the earth. Amen. We need God today in our everyday lifestyle. How do you know? Well, if I didn't have God in my everyday lifestyle, my life would be such a wreck. Amen. I don't know if I would be alive today to talk to you about it if God wasn't in my life. The lifestyle that I was living, I tell you what, I was on my way to hell and headed on an unchanging course. Amen. But the moment I acknowledged Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior, all of a sudden, the penalty of the sin that was in my life was lifted. Amen? Was lifted. What do you mean was lifted? The Bible said the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Well, when I acknowledged that I needed prayer, how did I acknowledge that I needed prayer? I began to pray. I began to talk to my Father. Amen? I began to pray. I began to talk to my Father. Amen? Which is in heaven. And I began to say, our Father. I didn't know how to pray, but I remember that what they taught us in high school, amen, what they taught us in elementary school growing up, they said, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. I didn't really know how to pray, but when I was praying, whatever I said, I was sincere from my heart. I was sincere from my heart, and God heard me, amen, and God delivered me, and he stopped me right in my track on the course that I was headed, amen, because I was headed to hell and going fast. Amen. And a lot of you are headed in the same direction. A lot of you are headed in the same direction. Amen. And so God is looking for a people that will pray. God is looking for a people that will make up the hedge and stand in the gap for the people of the land. Amen. God is looking for a people that will say, God, you don't have to look no further. Here am I. Send me. I'll go. Amen. So will you make that bold stand? Will you make that bold stand and say, God, you don't have to look no further. I'll be the one that you can use in these last days. I will make up the hedge. I will stand in the gap before you for the land that you will not destroy. Amen. That you can forgive our, that you can forgive the land, that you will heal our land. Amen. Because God wants to heal our land. There's a lot of wickedness in the earth today. There's a lot of wickedness in the earth today, and God is looking for someone that will make up the hedge and stand in the gap. Amen. And I'm wondering, will that be you? Will that be you? Amen. Glory to God. God is looking for someone that will make up the hedge and stand in the gap. And I'm just wondering in my heart, will that be you? Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Because see, God is not, he's not looking at where you are. He's not looking at even who you are. He's looking at who he created you to be. Amen. Glory to God. He's looking at what he created you to be, who he created you to be. Amen. So God is looking at you right now, right where you are. Hallelujah. Amen. So it says in verse number 14, it says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray, amen, and seek my face. See, these are things that we have responsibility to do. This is not God's responsibility. This is our responsibility as the born-again churches of Almighty God. We have been given the responsibility to pray, to seek his face, and to turn from our wicked ways, so then we will hear from heaven, he will heal our land, he will forgive us of our sin. Amen. Glory to God. He will forgive us of our sin, and he will heal our land. How many know that our land needs, our land needs forgiving today? There's a lot of wickedness in the land today. Amen. A lot of wickedness in the land today, and there's a need for forgiveness. Amen. And we, as the people of God, need to understand that if we don't intercede, if we don't come together and begin to cry out to God on behalf of the world, then the blood of the world is going to be up on our hands. Amen. It's going to be up on our hands. We will not hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," because we have not did what he asked us to do. What did he tell Peter and John while he was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying? When he come back and found them asleep, he said, "Can you not watch and pray with me 1 hour?" Amen. "Can you not watch with me 1 hour?" Amen. So we need to understand that God, this is our hour. This is our hour that God is saying, "Can you watch with me 1 hour?" Amen. So this is the hour that God is asking us to watch with him and to pray. Amen. To watch and pray. Glory to God. Amen. See, here is God's strategy for revival. This is God's strategy for revival. If we don't pray, folks, we won't see no revival in our land. If we don't come together in unity as the church of God, we won't see true revival in our land. This is the key to revival. Amen. Prayer is the key to revival. What happened? What do you mean prayer is the key to revival? Because prayer, it ushers you right into the presence of God. And in the presence of God, there are signs, wonders, and miracles that are going to take place. Why? Because you're not walking in your own ability. Your wisdom has been suspended, and now the wisdom of God is beginning to take over your thoughts. Amen? And now the anointing of God begins to rest upon you because you're not yielding to your way, but you're yielding to his way. Amen? How did that happen? When you start spending time with him, his personality is beginning to overtake your personality. Amen. Because the one you hang around, the one with the strongest personality is gonna override the one with the lesser personality, the weaker personality. So when we come around God, God's personality is a whole lot stronger than ours. Guess what, folks? When we step into God's presence, when God enters into our presence, his personality is gonna begin to take over. His personality is gonna begin to take over. And we're gonna begin to see ourselves being washed and purged and cleansed and purified. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Because see, when God comes, he will come as a refinery fire. He's gonna purge us. Amen. He's gonna purify us. He's gonna clean us that we may be worthy to stand in his presence. Amen. He's not there to hurt us. He's not there to harm us. He's there to make us everything he created us to be from the foundation of the world. Amen, amen, amen. Glory to God. And I'm telling you that we're in the right place right now at the right time. Now notice what he said again here in the book of Chronicles chapter 7. Now notice what it said again, verse number 12. I'm going to take you back up again to verse number 12. Because we need to understand there's power, amen, in the presence of God through prayer. There's power in the presence of God through prayer. Glory to God. Notice what he said in Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 12. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, "I have heard thy prayer." Notice what he said, "I have heard thy prayer." See, when God hears your prayer, it changes everything around you. It changes your own heart. Amen. It causes you to begin to pay attention to what you're saying to him. Amen. A lot of people pray, they're not even paying attention to what they're saying to God. Amen. And they think that God's supposed to answer all their foolish talking. Amen. God is not going to answer your foolish talking. God is going to answer his word. That's why it's so important that we take a hold of the word of God and begin to seek God's face using the word as our platform. As our platform. Notice what he said in verse number 12 again. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night. Notice what? He didn't come when Solomon was busy taking care of his daily chores. Amen. He came when Solomon's heart and mind was at rest. He came in the nighttime when Solomon, I can imagine, was somewhere resting. Amen. He came when he was somewhere resting. And so the Bible said he appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, "I have heard thy prayer and have chosen." Notice what he did? After he heard his prayer, he was chosen. The place that he heard his prayer from was chosen. Amen. Was chosen for a place of sacrifice. Amen. God wants your prayers to come before him as a living sacrifice. Glory to God. See, when we understand how to come into God's presence, we won't come boasting. We won't come commanding. We won't come griping and complaining. But we will come humble. We will come humble into the presence of God. Amen. Glory to God. Know what they said now? Amen. I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself. Amen. This is God talking. I have chosen the place unto myself for a house of sacrifice. For a house of sacrifice. Amen. God will take your house and use it for a sacrifice. Now, when I'm referring to a house right now, I'm not talking about some building. Amen. I'm not talking about some building that men got together and put and made a building, you know, for someone to go and rest at home, rest at night and stuff, and throughout the day and everything. I'm talking about the house that wasn't made by hand. I'm talking about this house. Amen. My body. My body. Because my body is the temple of God. Amen. So God will make this house. This house. My body. Amen. God will make my body his, glory to God. Knows what he's saying? His house of sacrifice. This body will become a house of sacrifice. When? When I begin to take time out of my daily routine and spend time with him. See, I'm sacrificing some things that I really want to get done, amen, from a natural standpoint, and I'm sacrificing doing something that is more important than those things that I really need to get done in the natural. What am I doing? I'm leaving the natural things and I'm cleaving to the spiritual things. Amen. Isn't that what, and then what Jesus said to Martha, Mary, when Martha was down at the foot, listened to all his words, he said, Martha had chosen the best thing. Amen. She had chosen the best thing. What was that? To hear the word of the Lord, to sit down at his feet and feast from the words of his mouth. God is wanting us to begin to feast on the word, that the word will come alive on the inside of us, and then when we begin to pray, when we begin to talk to God, when we begin to communicate with God, we won't communicate from a natural standpoint, but we'll communicate from a spiritual standpoint. What I mean by that? We'll communicate back to him his word. Yes, his word. Because his word is what's going to make a difference in the life of the people. Amen. So when we pray, when we're praying, when we're seeking the face of God, folks, we are doing it by faith. We are doing it by faith, knowing that God will hear us. When we know that God hears us, we know we have petition we desire of him. Amen. So now let me read that verse again. I'm going to read it one more time. This time we'll read all the way through. Amen. It said now, verse 2 Chronicles chapter 12, verse number 4, verse number 2 Chronicles chapter 12 and verse number 7. Chapter 7 and verse number 12. I get it right in a minute. I'm getting caught up now. Amen. I'm getting caught up now. So it's in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 12. Amen. And it said, and the Lord appeared unto Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place for my house of sacrifice. And I've chosen this place for my house of sacrifice. Amen. Now if you know he's talking about the temple that Solomon had built. Amen. And when God spoke that, amen, the sacrifice was consumed. If you read the Bible, you see all that. Amen. You read the Bible, you see all that. But then it goes on to say in verse number 13, if I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people. See, all these things are if. Amen. All these things are if. Why are so many ifs? Why are there so many ifs? Because see, there's a response that God is looking for from us. He's looking for a response from us. Because you notice in verse number 14, he said again, but he was talking about you and me at this time. Verse number 14, he said, if my people, amen, if my people. So he's not talking about the people of the world. He's not talking about the Satanists. He's not talking about the Antichrist people. He's not talking about the atheists. He's talking about you. And he's talking about me. He's talking about us. Amen. He's talking about his people. He said, if my people. Because see, if he said, if my people, that means if they hear, or if they will not hear, that means that there's a consequence because they have neglected to hear. But look at the promise that if you would hear. Look at the promise if you would hear. He said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, glory to God, shall humble themselves and pray, amen. See, what was Solomon doing that God called him a house of sacrifice? What was Solomon doing? Solomon was praying. He was praying. Amen. He was praying. Now, he said, if my people would pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. God is talking to us. Now, folks, it's up to us to pay attention to what God is saying. It's up to us to listen to what God is saying. Amen. Do you want to be a part of what God is saying, or what God is doing in these last days? Do you want to be a part of the great revival that is coming to the land? Well, glory to God. I know I do. I want to be a part of it. I want to be one of those that will hear God say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Because you've been faithful in the things that I asked you to do, I'm going to cause you to be ruler over much. Amen. I want to be one of them people. Amen. So he said, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open. Notice what it said in verse number 15. Now my eyes shall be open and my ears attend to their prayer. Attend to the prayer that is made in this place. Amen. My eyes shall be open, my ears shall be attentive to the prayers that are made in this place. God wants to hear your prayers. God wants to hear you crying out to him on behalf of the land. God do not want the earth to be destroyed because of sin. Amen. Because of rebellion. Because of a people that has the heart of Satan. Amen. God placed his spirit in the earth that we would choose life. Amen. That we would choose life. Now, if we would choose life, better are ye. But if you do not choose life, whoa, until then, glory to God. Verse number 15 says again, now mine eyes shall be opened up, and my ears attend into the prayer that is made in this place. Amen. Made in what place? In the house of sacrifice. The prayers are made in the house of sacrifice. Amen. For now have I chosen and sacrifice this house that my name may be there forever. Amen. Amen. God wants to place his name there forever. Where? At the place of sacrifice, the house that you have established to seek God's face. Amen. The place of sacrifice. Solomon was at that place. It was at nighttime, when he was least expecting, and God visited him. God visited him and said, I have heard your prayer, and I've chosen this place for myself to be a house of sacrifice. Amen. Why won't God do the same thing for you? Amen. If you will pray earnestly and seek the face of God without an ungodly motive behind your seeking God, I believe that God will speak to you the same way he spoke to Solomon. He begin to tell you everything you need to know at the time you need to know it. Because there's an enemy that's working overtime that is trying to steal the attention of the people of God, trying to stop the prayer of God in the earth. Amen. We are God's people. We can pray, we can seek the face of God, we can do what God has said for us to do, we can accomplish everything that God has said that we can accomplish, but we have to unite together, become as one body, amen, become as one body, and when we unite together, become as one body, we will see the hand of God moving like never before. Friend, this is the finest hour. power that the church has ever experienced. God is about to pour out a freshness of his presence throughout the earth, and the people of God that is praying, the people of God that is seeking his faith, the people of God that has made a decision that they're going to follow God no matter what happened, amen, they're not going to compromise, not going to give up, not going to throw in the towel. These people are going to be the one that are going to take a hold of the presence of God and the anointing of God and walk in the power of God. Amen. Walking in the power of God. Hallelujah. And I tell you what, I believe that I'm going to be one of them, because I'm doing what God called me to do, and I'm doing it with all my heart. I'm doing it with all my heart. Verse number 16 says, For now have I chosen and sacrificed this house, that my name may be there, that my name, glory to God, may be there forever. And my heart shall be there perpetually. Amen. Verse 17. And as for thee, if thou would walk before me as David thy father walked, and do according to all that I have commanded thee, and would observe my statutes and my judgment. Verse 18. Then will I establish the throne of thy kingdom according as I have covenanted with thee, thy father, saying, there shall not fail thee a man to be ruler in Israel. God wants to do something so significant in the life of the people. God wants to touch the heart of his people. And I'm telling you, you are in the right place at the right time. And you are stationed. And you are, and I'm telling you, you're going to be glad that you made it to that place. Amen. Glory to God. You're going to be glad that you made it to the place. Let's turn to the book of Isaiah, chapter 56. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 56, I'm going to show you another scripture that really touched my heart. Amen. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 56, and I want to look at verse number 7. Verse number 7. Amen. And it says, Even them will I bring to my holy mountain. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in the house of prayer. Amen. And make them joyful in the house of prayer. See, folks, when we begin to pray, we begin to seek God's face, it changes everything around us. And this is why when everybody started praying, that's why all that hell broke loose on last week to get your attention off of what God was doing in the earth, amen. When all that started, God told me two things. God said, this is a distraction that the enemy has caused that he can move his troops in position. This is the one thing God told me. And then the second thing God told me, God said, the people will retaliate against the police officers. And both of these things came to pass. Amen. Both of these things came to pass. Amen. So God is telling us, but if we're not praying, if we're not spending time with God in prayer, then we will not hear when God is talking to us. Amen. God is talking, and God is wanting us to hear what he's saying in these last days. And so if we're not spending time with him, we're not fellowship with him, we will never hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. And so we need to understand that. Because see, many people are praying, but are they praying the will of God? Are they praying the will of God? Amen. And that's what God is looking for, people that are praying the will of God. Notice what it says in verse number 17. That's Isaiah chapter 56 and verse number 7. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Notice what it says, make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifice shall be accepted upon my altar, for my house shall be called an house of prayer for all nations. Amen. For all people. Amen. for all people. So when we are praying, we're doing exactly, we're falling right in line with what God is expecting out of us. Amen. We're falling right in line to what God is expecting out of us. Because if we are doing what God has called us to do, friend, we, oh God, it's just like God is the, he's going to reveal himself as the ideal. You know what an ideal is? Okay, I'm going to say it like this. He's going to reveal himself as the ideal father. Amen. He's going to reveal himself as the ideal father. In other words, the one that will not say no to you. The one that will not hold back from you. The one that will not turn his back on you. Amen. See, an ideal father is one that's going to love you no matter what you're doing. Amen. No matter where you are, no matter what you, where you're at. An ideal father is the one that's going to, have that unconditional love. That whatever you're doing, he's going to reach out to you. And he's going to bring correction. He's going to bring restoration. Amen. But he's not going to turn his back on you. Amen. And so when we are praying, when we're talking to the Father, then he's not going to, we're not going to be looked upon as bastards, fatherless. We're going to be looked upon as sons. Amen. We're going to be looked upon as daughters. Amen. We're going to be looked upon as children of Almighty God. And then how do we know when we, how do we know which way to go? The Bible tells us in the back, in the book of John, in the book of John, chapter 14, verse number 6, Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Amen. So if we're going to make it to the Father, we got to learn that Jesus is the doorway. And how do we get through? How are we going to get to Jesus? We're going to get to Jesus by a spirit of humility. Spirit of humility. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. And then I want you to look at the book of Galatians with me. Galatians chapter 3. In the book of Galatians chapter 3, glory to God. Hallelujah. Are y'all getting anything out of this today? Amen, amen, amen. In the book of Galatians, and I want to look at chapter 3. That's Corinthians. There we go, Galatians. Galatians chapter 3. I want to look at verse number 26 and 27. Are you with me? Amen. Galatians chapter 3. Verse number 26 and 27. Glory to God. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. So we are his children. We're not bastards. We are not someone, some outcast that all of a sudden didn't have no place to go. But we heard of God, and so we came to God knowing that he was God. No, that's not the way we came to God. We came to God when God began to tug at our hearts. Amen. Notice what he says right here in verse number 26 again. For ye, this is Galatians chapter 3, verse number 26. For ye are all the children of God. Amen. See, now, if we are children of God, and if when we are praying, we have a right to use the name Abba, Father. Amen. Because that word Abba, that word was the word that the children in the Old Testament, that's where they addressed their fathers. Abba. Amen. Abba. Glory to God. That implies that you have an intimate relationship. An intimate relationship. Amen. And this is what God is looking for us. He wants us to come to him saying, Abba, Father. Then you can say Daddy. Because that word Abba, in our language today, that means daddy. Amen. That means daddy. Amen. So when we say Abba, Father, Daddy, that's what they said. I have a strong relationship. I have a relationship with him close, so close that I can call him daddy. Amen. That I can look to him as my daddy. I can look to him as my source. I can look to him as my supplier of all, the supplier of all of my needs. I can look to him as the one who supply all my needs because he is my father. Amen. And the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. Amen. So he's my father. He's my daddy. So in verse number 26, Galatians chapter 3, verse number 26, it says, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many as For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Amen. So when you became a born-again child of God, you put on Christ. So now you have a legal right to go into the presence of God because you have taken on the nature of His Son. Now you're no longer an heir. You're no longer a joint heir. You are sons and you are daughters. You have a right to go into your Father's arms. Amen. Just look at this right here. You see this thing behind me back here, this big brown organ behind me. Amen. Just think of that organ as God's big throne. Amen. God is sitting up on the throne. And the Bible said in Isaiah chapter 6, He's high and lifted up. Amen. And the train fills the temple. Now all of a sudden, you became a born-again child of God. You was living a hellacious, wicked life. And all of a sudden, God tugged at your heart, and you answered God. And God came, and you came to God and said, God, please forgive me of my sin. And I know that I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son, that He died for my sin. And I ask Jesus Christ now to come into my heart and not just to live His life in me, but to be the Lord of my life. Amen. To be the Lord of my life. So that means I've just surrendered my will to the will of God. Amen. So now I have a right, a legal right, to come into God's presence because of the blood that was shed for me on Mount Calvary. I have a legal right to come into God's presence. Amen. Now, when I became a born again child of God, I didn't just become born again. I became delivered. I became healed. I became free from the penalty of sin. Amen. It's more than you. When you become a born again child of God, it's more than just salvation. Amen. But you, because salvation works in a threefold. It works in a threefold. Amen. There's a deliverance from poverty, deliverance from sickness and disease, and deliverance from spiritual death. Amen. So when I come into God's presence, now I'm able to come before the big throne of God, and I'm able to stand here, and I can look up, and I can talk with my Father, and glory to God. You know what He's going to do? He's not going to look down upon me with an evil eye. And I can see God sitting upon His big old throne right now, and it is high and lifted up like the scripture said in the Bible, and He just reaches down His big old God hand and pick up little old me and put me up into His lap, and I'm sitting there in His lap just looking up and just crying. Oh my God, just boo-hooing, you know, because I'm in the presence of my Father, the one that loved me, the one that will never hurt nor leave me, forsake me. Amen. So I'm in His presence. I'm in His presence. How did I get into His presence? It came about when I started praying. When I started praying, I was able to come into His presence. Amen. Amen. When I began to pray, I was ushered into His presence. And this is what God is calling for the church today. The church needs to begin to pray and go back into the presence of God to obtain the power and the anointing to defeat this kingdom of this world. Because the kingdom of this world is not the kingdom of our God. Because the devil, the kingdom of the world is the kingdom of God. And we need to take back what God has given us. And we won't take it back by looking at it. Ooh, look over there, what they doing over there. Ooh, look over there. No, we won't take the world back that way. The only way we're going to take the world back, folks, is that we begin to pray and seek the face of God. That's the only way we're going to take the world back today. Begin to pray and seek the face of God. Pray and seek the face of God. God is looking for a man, and God is looking for a woman. Someone that will take it to heart the job to pray. Yes, it's a job because it's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. Amen. To some, they don't want to do it. And for some, they can't wait to do it because they know the ultimate price for praying. God will call your house a house of sacrifice. Amen. A house of sacrifice and prayer. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, now, I'm going to take you to one more scripture. And, amen. We're going to go to one more scripture. And then we're going to, after we go from there, We're gonna pray a little bit. Look here in the book of Let me make sure that's where I want to go. Amen. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to His name. Are y'all getting anything out of this today? My God, I sure am. I know I'm feeling it, boy. It's just like hot water, hot liquid fire all over me. Amen. Hot liquid fire all over me. Glory to God. Okay, let's go to the book of Matthew. And I want you to look with me here at chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, and I want also to look at verse number 13. Amen. Verse number 13 and 14. Glory to God. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 13 and 14. And it says, ye are the salt of the earth. Now he's talking about you and he's talking about me. Because when we are praying, we usher in the presence of God. Amen. And the presence of God comes upon our life and it brings a different flavor. Or you might say a different fragrance. Amen. Notice what he said in verse number 3 again. Ye are salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. Ye, verse number 14, ye are the light of the world. See, this is what God is saying about you and about me. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Amen. See, God is looking at us in a whole different way than we see ourselves. When you start to see yourself the way God sees you, you'll find out that the way God sees you is a whole lot more pleasant than the way you're seeing yourself. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I want to go one more place now to the book of Hebrews. Let's go to the book of Hebrews. I've got a couple more scriptures for you today, then we're gonna start praying. Amen. We're gonna pray a few minutes. And don't y'all forget now, Thursday and Friday are the days that we pray 9 in the morning, 12 at noon, and 3 in the evening. These prayer times are only 10 minutes at a time. But I know if you're anything like me, you can't just pray 10 minutes. Sometimes that's all I can pray because of what I'm doing, but at least I get my 10 minutes in. And don't forget, sometimes you have to set your alarm clock in order to make sure you don't miss your time of prayer, your appointment with God. Amen. That's what I call them, appointment with God. Glory to God. Now, in the book of, the book of Hebrew. That's where I want. Yeah. Book of Hebrew. And I want us to look here at, let's look at chapter 4 first. Hebrew chapter 4. And let's look at verse number 14. Hebrew chapter 4, verse number 14. It says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but as in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Amen. So Jesus is showing us that no matter what type of temptation you experience or what you go through in life, that you can withstand the temptations that the world is bringing. Amen. You can hold fast. You can be strong. Jesus has already showed you that it could be done. Amen. He has set the pace for us. Amen. To follow. Now, notice what it says now. Verse number 15. He said, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmity, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." Then he said, verse number 16, "Let us therefore come boldly." See, he said, "Let us therefore come boldly. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Amen. That we may find grace and mercy in time of need. God wants to do something right now in our life, and he is expecting us to be a part of what he's doing. And the only way that's going to happen is that we have confidence in God. Amen. And to approach approach the throne of grace as he has instructed us to, with a humble spirit. Amen. With a humble spirit. Now, I want to take you to one more section of scripture. Amen. Then we're going to be closing out. Let's go to chapter 7. Chapter 7. Amen. Chapter 7 and verse number 25. "But this man, because he continued, even had an unchangeable priesthood, which is wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them." Amen. For them. See, Jesus, he's showing us the possibilities and the power that we as intercessors walk in. Notice what he says right here, verse number 26, "For such an high priest becometh us, who is holy," amen, "who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens." Amen. Talking about Jesus. Amen. Notice this now. The Old Testament priests were limited by what they could do. Amen. But listen, folks, you are not limited, because you have a high priest. You have a high priest, the one that is seated right now on the right hand of the Father. Now, not only is he seated right in the Father, but you've been caught up with him, and you're seated in heaven places according to Ephesians chapter 2. Amen. You're seated in heaven places in Christ Jesus. Now, notice where we at. We are above the principalities and powers and might and dominion, and whatever we do is for the glory of God and for the kingdom of God. Amen. So, folks, when we do what God has called us to do, we are doing it out of love, through the love of God and in faith. Amen. Well, glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. Well, I'm going to close it right now. I thank God for all of you that have been with us today, all of you that have joined us today, and I know that God is going to do something great and mighty in your midst. Amen. Well, if you're here today and you never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, I'm going to give you that opportunity right now. Amen. You never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, you have that opportunity. You can say, "Lord, just, you know, that's me." Just raise your hand right where you are. Amen. Say, "That's me. I need to be set free. I need Jesus in my heart. I need to prepare my heart for eternity." Amen. And so the way we prepare our eternity is through Jesus Christ. It's through Jesus Christ. Amen. So say this prayer with me. If you've never been born again, you're looking for a change in your life, and you know that change is only going to come through Jesus Christ. It won't come through no other way but through Jesus Christ. Amen. Or if you are born and you have been born again, you turn away from God, and you say, "Pastor, I want to rededicate my life to God. I want to get my heart right with God." If that's you, then I want you to say this prayer also. Amen. I want you to say this prayer also. Glory to God. Say it with me now. Say, "Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sin, because I believe that you are the Son of God. And I believe that you came into this earth to die for my sin. Now I'm asking you to forgive me of my sin and come into my heart, create in me a right spirit, and renew in me a clean heart. Thank you, Lord. I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Amen. If you said that simple prayer, that's a simple prayer. That's true. But if you said that simple prayer, God has delivered you. God has set you free. God has come into your heart right now. Amen. Glory to God. Well, we're going to take about eating it off now. If you have a love gift you want to give to God right now, if you want to sow through the internet, you may give to God through the internet by giving, going to my website, LiveBurgerMinistries.com, and there you can plant your seed into the ministry. Amen. There you can plant your seed into the ministry. Glory to God. And if you have a testimony, you may also give your testimony, send us your testimony. You have a prayer request, you may also send your prayer request. We would love to pray with you. We would love to come in agreement with you. Amen. We would love to share what God is doing in your life. And also, if you have a good testimony, share your testimony with us and let us be a part and let us rejoice with you also. Amen. And if you're going to be given through the mail system, you may make your check payable to Library Ministries, and that's P.O. Box 417913, Sacramento, California 95841. Amen. That's P.O. Box 417913, Sacramento, California 95841. Amen. So you may take your prayer request right now. Take your offering orders to God right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, as they have given, Father, here in this church, in this building, Father, and I pray for those that are given through the internet, Father, those that are given from around the world. God, let their gift be sanctified. Let it be touched by you, Father, that it will multiply. Father, in the name of Jesus, oh God, I thank you, Lord God, for your word will not return void. Oh Jesus, thank you so much. You said when we give, it shall be given unto us. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall be given unto our bosom. Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus that you will bless your people, Lord God, that is supporting this ministry. Father, I ask you, Lord God, that you will cause them to become debt free. I ask you, Father, that you will give them, Father, a way out of that bill, that hospital bill that they have, Father, in the name of Jesus, because they honored you, because they've given, Father. God, you're going to supernaturally move upon their behalf, Father, that bill, that big bill that's way above their head will be paid, Father, in full, supernaturally. And that mortgage, Lord God, is going to be paid in full, supernaturally, because, Father, when we give, it is given to us. So, Father, we thank you. We bless you right now. I ask you, Father, to bless the people supernaturally, pressed down, shaken together, running over, that men give back into their bosom. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, glory to God. Amen. Yeah, and those of you that have a special prayer request right now, I will pray for you. If you have a special prayer request right now, I will pray for you. Amen.
Listen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, for my sister. And I ask you, Father, that you would minister to her heart, that you would bless her, Father, on the crown of her head and the soles of her feet. God, let your miracle work of power right now go to work on her behalf. I bless her in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Everybody's all right? Amen. Well, let's pray for those that are viewing by the internet. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we stretch forth our hand toward those that are with us, those that are watching us, those that are listening to us by the internet, Father. I release my faith, Father, in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord God, for divine health and healing. Father, from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet, I release the anointing to drive out those spirit of infirmities, sicknesses, and diseases. I release my faith, God, and I declare divine health and healing right now in the name of Jesus. I command that heart to begin to function properly right now. I command that clogged artery be unstopped now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, and I ask you, Lord God, let the arthritis be healed. Rheumatoid arthritis, be healed right now. I command that pain to leave those joints right now in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you, and I praise you, and I bless you, and I glorify you. And I give you all the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Don't forget to join us on this coming Sunday at 12:30, amen, Pacific Standard Time, amen, Sunday noonday. Join us at 12:30 Pacific Standard Time, noonday. And be ready to hear the word, because God has a word in my spirit, and I just can't wait to release that word on Sunday. God bless you. We'll see you then. Bye-bye.